Good morning. Thank you very much for inviting me. And as it's just to say, today we are launching a new campaign. It's about the copper mining in the Democratic Republic of Congo. Okay. And at the end of my presentation, I will show you a video that it clearly shows how the cobalt today is extracted in the Katanga, more precisely, where it goes, what they are doing with the cobalt, and what the company who are using the device produced with this cobalt are answering when we are asking them about the violation they are committed to extract the cobalt. But first, yes, I am a pharmacist by training. I am not a lawyer. Everybody thinks that when you have someone from Amnesty, it's a lawyer. I am not, okay. And in fact, Amnesty is really an organization with citizens that are committed and they become activists of human rights. But it's everybody. You can be part of Amnesty if you are not yet. Okay. And then today, vous pouvez. Okay. In the agenda, I will go rapidly about Amnesty, what is Amnesty, and why we are working on business and human rights, why we are so concerned about the. Violation committed by the corporation. Second, I will introduce the context of corporation and human rights, also the legal framework where we can we base our work or what we are today lobbying in order to enforce the law in the different countries. And at the end, I will show you some campaign. What we are doing and what, and for you to understand, and this is really important, when we speak about human rights violation conducted by corporation or by their relationship or their entities in the different country is really, really strong violation. It's not just, you know, sometimes people think that what they are doing, it's maybe they don't respect the labor regulation or things like that, but really it can, and I will show you, it can lead to conflict, armed conflict, and it can lead to death. And this is a huge issue for us. Okay? Then Amnesty was created in 1961 by a lawyer, Peter Benenson, and it was mainly about prisoners of conscience. And our main purpose at this time was really to mobilize the citizens around the world for them to write about prisoners of conscience. The term of prisoner of conscience was created by Amnesty years ago, and it concerned people that they are in prison just because of their opinion, and they didn't call for violence, they didn't call for anything specific, just they expressed their opinion. Today, the category of, at the beginning, everybody, the prisoner of conscience was mainly political opponent because we were in the middle of the World War, but today, prisoner of conscience is also LGBT people, it's also union representative, it's also activist for environment issue, it's indigenous people, human rights defender. The definition cover the frame of the prison of conscience is really wide. But in the since 1991, and this is just after the Soviet Union collapse, you know, we expand from economical, civil and political rights, okay, to economical, social and cultural rights. And the reason why is because the frame of the violation changed a lot, and more it appears that the violation, again, it wasn't just because of political opinion, but it was also related with economical issue, land problem, problem of minority, discrimination, and poverty. And then it was a need for us to expand. The second point here is that, you know, at the beginning, we were focusing only, or targeting, I will say, only state, because the corpus of regulation, law, convention, treaties that exist at international level, it's really the state that has to comply. It means that they have to protect the human rights themselves, but they have to ensure that all the others, or groups or organizations of people, also they respect, and they have to enforce their own local law to be sure that human rights will be respected. But what we can observe is that from 1991, two new categories merge. First, the armed group, and today when we see what is happening with the groups like Boko Haram, with Daesh, but also other groups around the world, you can understand easily why also we are targeting those groups that are not really related with any, I will say, state as it was, as it used to be during the Cold War. The second aspect is about business and corporation, because here we see that with the globalization, you know, you have entities that multinational, transnational, that are becoming really, really very big. Some of them, when you, you know, they have even more employees around the across the world than some state they have citizens. And in terms of revenue, some if you take the 100 bigger, I will not say fortune, but revenue in the world, you have almost half-half, there are state, half are corporation. And means that they have a lot of power. Just this is why we enter on this field. Just also to remember you that in 1977, we were awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for our fighting against torture. And since 2008, we are campaigning not only about torture, death penalty, all these civil political rights, but really we have this campaign demanding dignity. Okay, this is just our mission is about all, we cover today all the human rights, and of course, you know, our position, because this is very strong for Amnesty, are based on international human rights, regional human rights, and also local human rights. We never take position because of political or economic or religious or philosophical influence. We are fully independent, and this is for us is very, very important, and this is the reason why we don't receive and we don't get any money from any state and corporation, and we really, for us, the impartiality and the credibility of Amnesty when we issue a report, for us is key. How, what do we do? You know, you have different organizations working on human rights today. And what is the Amnesty specific is that not only we make research, not only we issue reports, we communicate a lot on the media, but also when we campaign, or campaigning is about lobbying, is about signature, etc., we involve activists. It means that from the research, we have our own research with our own people going really where the violations are committed. We have people in they go to Syria, they are not staying all the time there. We just issued this week a report about the violation committed by the combatant of the Kurd and the Peshmergas in the northern of Iraq. It means that we send researchers there. They interview people, they took pictures, they meet with different NGOs, and then we issue a report. But, you know, from this, to the campaigning, and it goes really to the activists like me that they are going then to lobby, to go to the media, and to also communicate with the people. And another important point is the human rights education we are conducting. This is just to show you how we organize. We have international secretariat plus in London, where all the decisions are taken in terms of what are the action we are going to make, the campaign, etc. And we have now for the last 2-3 years were some hubs in the different region. We have a hub in Dakar, one in Nairobi, another one, for instance, in Johannesburg. We just opened one in Mexico and in Hong Kong. We are opening in Bangkok, and this is to be closer to the field. Then we have what we call the section. It means country by country we have organization, the French section. Just to give you an idea, we have 50,000 members today, over 200,000 donors, and we have groups and youth, youth group, I will say. I think today we have over 400. It means that we are everywhere in France, and it's the same in the big and major country. Okay, now this is why corporation, and this is typical, this is a picture about the Niger Delta with shale contamination and pollution that is lasting for over 50 years, and is one of the big campaigns we have been conducting for years, but I will explain what we did and what we obtained, okay? In fact, as I told you, okay, the context and the big challenge for us is that today you have many transnational that they are committing human rights violation. One of the sectors we are working more, it's about the mining sector, as this sector itself, it's responsible of 30% of the human rights violation committed by corporation and by business. This is huge violation, but is also understandable due the, but when I say it's understandable, you will understand why when I go more deeply in the in this sector. The other point is that from the globalization, it is really a big gap between, you know, what is the right, because they are really protected in order to conduct their business, but in the opposite, you know, it's in terms of for them to respect human rights, there is no real today framework at the international level. And if the state have to protect, you know, their citizens and the people that they are living in their territory, we can see that most of the time they are failing to that. And at the end, you know, one of the main problems we are facing today is not just because there are the violation, but also because behind, or after, I will say, they don't have access to justice. And this is also generating a big, you know, impunity for the people that they are suffering violation. It's something that it can really lead to violence. And this is very, very important, because when you don't get justice, when you have the feeling that the people who are violating your rights, there are, you know, they are benefiting, because this is really the case, about impunity, and you cannot sue them, there is no solution, then it's it really generates violence. And if we today, if we can see that we have a legal framework for the state and to protect human rights, we don't have any binding legal or any regulation that protects the human rights from human rights violation committed by corporation. Okay, when we it's interesting, because now for years, and the UN, the United Nations, has been working on business on human rights. But if we take the binding chart for state, the first one is what we called the Bill for Human Rights. It's composed of three texts. One is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights adopted in 1948, and this is a non-binding test. You know, it's universal declaration, and all the international text, when it's just a declaration and not convention, is not binding. But it's applied to all of the states, part of the UN. But so if you don't have, you know, the treaty or the convention, that it will be signed and ratified by the state that are really binding, you know, you don't really have a tool to work on the violation. And then is the reason why there are two covenants. There is the International Covenant for the Political and Civil Rights, and the one from for Economical, Social and Cultural Rights. They are in force since 1976. It took a lot of time to get them in force. What do we mean in force? Typically for the first one, the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, we have a mechanism, you know, that is going to follow the implementation by the state party of the treaty, and also it's in this case is the Human Rights Committee, you know, where it's composed by independent experts, and this is a group that you, if you are a victim of violation, or if you are an organization that is supporting other victims, you can ask them, you know, to investigate, and even they can, after the investigation, they can take decision that the state will have to implement. But this is at the international level, but you have also other, this applied for the different treaty, but then you have other convention from the International Labour Organization that is more specific about labour, and other UN convention. You have regional and local text, and this is also important because, for instance, at the European level, you have specific tests. You have the Charter of the Human Rights, but you have also on the Americas, in Africa, there are now trying to build in Asia, and they have their specific court, and they have their specific system where the victim can go for justice once they have their claim has been rejected at all level in their country. You cannot go directly to them, but there are systems. And also there is the humanitarian international law. Humanitarian international law apply to what for the situation of war and conflict. And it's really very specific. But you can see that we have text, we have mechanism to follow up the implementation, and also we have mechanisms where the victims can apply for claims. Okay. Regarding the corporate social responsibility, here we have non-binding, really international reference. It means that until now we have not obtained that an international text really define the responsibility. But of course, you can see that there are a lot of treaties from, you know, from the International Labour Organization, from the OECD, from the IFC, from the, you have also the Global Compact from the United Nations, and we have also some policy defined but by sector, like for example one of the process we have been working a lot, and we continue to work. We issue one or 2 months ago a report on the diamond in Central Republic, RCA, c'est okay, CAR, yes, Central African Republic. Okay, and this is the Kimberley process is really about where are coming from, where are coming the diamond, and this is because of the really the this process was developed and I cannot say approved, but at least adopted, mainly after the war in Liberia and Sierra Leone, because of the blood. I don't know if some of you saw the movie Blood Diamond. Blood Diamond with Leonardo DiCaprio, no? Blood Diamond really shows how, you know, the armed group are using even children, you know, to extract the diamond from the mine, and then those diamonds are used to finance the war and mainly buy arms. And this is yesterday I saw on TV. They show again the also the other one is the war Lord of War. Okay, in this movie it's about arms, but it shows clearly how diamond were used and continue to be used from the information we have to buy arms. And in this case, they, of course, it's very difficult for us, you know, to obtain that the armed group stop extracting the diamond to buy arms. But what we can do, and is what we are doing with the Kimberley process, is that all the company and all in the different level of the chain of value, you know, the one who are using diamond for jewelry, for instance, they ensure themselves that there are they look for the origin of the diamond and they ensure themselves that they not extract from mine in territories where there is a conflict. And this is really very, very important because otherwise, you know, you have violation first on the extraction of the diamond, second because they buy arms and they use to kill people, and at the end we have a diamond on the a ring on our hands and somewhere, you know, it's really important for us just to be sure that the diamond that will be on the ring, you know, it's clean and it's not financing any war. Then we have all these processes and guidelines, but really this is a voluntary process. There are voluntary processes for corporations. They can follow it or not. Of course, it's better to have them than not to have. But this is really soft law, and they don't have any obligation, you know. And here you have other initiatives, but I will let you the presentation. Okay, but it's more guidelines, reports, etc. But at the end, what is the, I will say, the most advanced text today is the UN guiding principle that has been adopted by the UN in 2011. They were prepared, and really, John Rogic, who was the special rapporteur for business, on business and human rights, okay, he has been promoting this to the UN for years. And these principles are based on three feet. The first one is that the state is the one who is really responsible to protect human rights. And it's not just, as I told you at the beginning, to protect himself, the human rights, because we know that the first, I will say, organization to violate the human right is always the state. But not only they have to protect, they have to respect, but also they have to ensure that they will enforce the law that make all the other entities under their responsibility or their on their territory or under their jurisdiction, you know, they will respect the law. Because when we go to the corporation, you know, and here is where is really the failure of the system and the weakness of the system, is that corporations, they have to respect human rights, but they do it on the basis of local regulation. They are not committed with international regulation, but on local regulation. And what does it mean? It means that in countries where the legal framework is not strong enough, okay, they don't. Today they claim they are following, but they're respecting the law. But if it's, you know, when you have country where you have some labor, children labor, okay, and you don't have any protection in mining, you don't have any land protection, etc., they are saying we are respecting the law. And then you see the big gap, because finally transnational and but not only transnational and multinational company, they are using system, okay, and in their chain of value, for instance, you know, that allow them to operate in some country where they don't respect the same law from the country of origin. And they say, but they feel, they say, we are responsible, we are following the local regulation. And this third part is for the victims to have effective access to remedy. And this is where also the state are failing. And for us, you know, it's not just for us, but on the international framework, it's really, and in this guiding principle, it's really established first that all the corporations, the companies that are in their state jurisdiction, you know, the state is responsible if they violate the human rights. But and this is from the very small company to multinational, but it stopped where to their board. Okay, and there is a different protocol. They have to ensure themselves. They have the law protect the human rights, but also there are specific policies regarding the operation of the corporation in conflict area. Even this is a specific case and is related with humanitarian international law. It means that when you have a for instance, a French corporation that is operating in Central African Republic, you put in place guidelines, because as a state, there are obligations on the conflict area, but you have to be sure that your national corporation are going to respect it. For instance, when an armed embargo is declared, you know, you have to be. The state is responsible for the corporation selling arms. In the case French operations are going to respect this embargo, and this is really the state responsibility. Another aspect is that this applies also when the state is conducting himself business, because as you know, you have public corporation, okay, or where the state can be a shareholder, and then he doesn't have to apply to the private sector and not to the public, and he has also to ensure that all the public activity that are conducted related with business are respecting the human rights. And the third part is that when there are negotiating treaty, it can be at different level, it's to be sure that they are not going to include conditions that will will refrain or constrain on the respect of human rights. And this means that there are the principle really define the state obligation. And the difference between this and the this responsibility for the state and the responsibility for the corporation is this one. It's based on the human rights bill and chart that I introduced you. And then it's an obligation for the state. And if he doesn't respect that, okay, we can go with the victims, with the different court or the different committee to ask for justice. Regarding the corporation, okay, their responsibility is to respect human rights, but it's really clearly defined that they should avoid and address adverse human rights. But it's not an obligation, you know. It's a wishful thinking, you know. And in fact, here we are more on a moral responsibility than a legal responsibility. And then it's something completely voluntary. Of course, in the guiding principles, they define a lot of good practices, because this is what we are talking about here, good practices. And they define all the aspects. It means that they have to ensure themselves that they are not going to provoke by their activities, or not only by themselves directly, but also with the business relationship, with the supplier they are using, the subsidiary they have in the different country. They will prevent and they will repair, but just it's as they want. It's just of their willing. And also, the other aspect is the due diligence. And this is a point I will come back, because in terms of human rights due diligence, very often when you go to the, when you speak about CSR, corporate social responsibility, what you see, it's about nice report and what they do positive. Okay, for their environment and for their stakeholder. But here, when we are speaking about due diligence, what we ask is really, really, a report on their activity, the impact of their activities on human rights, and how to they repair, or even more, how they prevent from human rights violation. Typically, and this is something it's asked, for instance, for the insurance company, and even for, And we ask also with the international finance institution, you know, is that when they credit or investment are made on the big project, to be sure that all this due diligence to identify where the new activity is going to create a negative impact, not only on environment, but also on human rights, has to be defined, to have in the project itself all the solution to prevent from this human rights violation. And also here it's the question of the external communication. It's not just to communicate about what is positive, but also when there is a negative impact, when there is a failure, how it has been handled, and what are the solutions, and even the remediation that has been provided. And in fact, the first limit, anyway, on the state responsibility is the fact itself that when you take the case of the Human Rights Committee, that is on civil and political rights, there are, under this covenant, there are 18 treaties. And here you see that in terms of ratification, the process, I don't know how familiar you are with the UN process. First, you can lobby, in our case, for in the case of the armed treaty, we lobby during 20 years. Then the UN is going to adopt okay, the text of the new convention. And this can take 2, 3, 4 years. After the text has been adopted by the General Assembly, okay, each country itself has to sign it. When they sign it, they commit not to infringe it, but they are not at the stage they commit to apply it. You know, for this, what is needed is the ratification. Most of the time, the ratification is by the parliament, and then they have to introduce the new treaty in their own law. And here you can see on the 80 treaties, the different set of ratification. I don't know if it's clear. The dark blue is the country they ratified 15 to 18. The light blue is 10 to 45, to 14, sorry. And the orange one, it's from 5 to 9. And the red one, I think here is the Myanmar, it's less than 4. And then you can see that to apply the treaty and for us to be able to use this treaty, okay, to demand justice, if they didn't ratify it, it's very, very much difficult. And it's what many countries are doing. And you can see that, for instance, the United States is one of the countries today that has signed and ratified a few treaties, and not only in the field of civil and political rights. I think today, because last year Somalia signed this convention, this treaty, is the children, the right of children, and except South Sudan, that is a new state, the only state in the world who didn't ratify this convention about children's rights is the United States. It's very interesting, okay? And then it shows the difficulty.
It's for James, he will
need it. And yes, and one of the main reasons they don't ratify it is because with this treaty, you cannot have child soldier. It means soldier less than 18 years old, and there are today recruiting people less than 18 years old, and this is one of the reasons. It doesn't mean that the others respect the treaty they have ratified, but at least they did it. Okay, and also what we can see with this map is it gives us also an idea about the discrimination and the difficulty to access to rights, and of course to access to justice. And this is why we have so many campaigns today against discrimination. Then, you know, I spoke about the CSR, it means the corporate social responsibility. And this is what most of the corporations and companies today are having as a social responsibility, I will say. And they really show what they are going to do. When they open class, school, hospital, really what they make them feel nice, and their employees too, because they have the feeling that they are really improving the situation of the people, they are really contributing not only about their business, but also for the whole society. And it's very interesting because today, you know, investors, the funds, etc., all the finance planet, it's very much interested in having a good image of what they are doing, and the company also are really communicating on the positive aspect. But for us, we have to change from should protect to must protect, and for this reason, we are asking for international treaty or international covenant that to ensure that transnational company will be responsible not only in their country of origin when they have binding law, but also in all their activities. Not to have them responsible regarding the level of the law, the local law, but really at the international level, and to respect human rights wherever they are operating. And this is really very important. For this, then we are asking for a hard law that to be transnational. And that will apply not only on the main of, okay, the headquarter, we'll say, but to all the entities, to all the subsidiaries, whatever the link, the kind of legal link they can have, and also to the third party. And the third point is, but the last point is really, really to have human rights due diligence. It's not just to say what we are doing good, but really to have with independent expert, with investigator, really to have a strong analysis about the activities conducted, their impact, not only because this is positive aspect about environment, because when they speak about environment, it's always positive what we are doing. But when it comes to human rights, there are several problems. And okay. I will come back. Then you see for us the main issue is about how we make really the state accountable and for them to respect their international commitment, and how we achieve that corporations are not just responsible at regarding the local regulation, but also regarding the international regulation on human rights. Before we go just to the campaigning we have developed, you know, you have from the research to the campaigning. And of course, to do that, we are not only issuing a report that we communicate to the media, but also to the authorities, to the different UN entities, etc. But a big aspect, and this is even more important when it comes from corporation, is to raise the awareness of the public on the situation. For this reason, beside the reports, beside the press release, etc., also we are developing our own movie or on video, okay, to explain the issue to go to internet, to be shared on internet, Facebook, Twitter. It's really very important. But also we support some kind of movie. In the case of Blood Diamond, or in the case of Lord of War, we were partner, and we use them also to organize debate and really CES to bring awareness to the public for them to mobilize. And it works really well because when we have a report and we can identify a violation, first we start with the dialogue and with the corporation. We inform them about what did you do. Did you? Sorry, I need water. It's not mine. I just hope it's good. And then we start informing about what we found. Then, okay, they listen or they don't. Then we have a concertation part. It means that we try to work with them and to identify how they can improve the situation. At the end, we denounce. It means that if we cannot, we go nowhere with the report and they are completely blocked, then we make it public. But one point is sure is that we never have partnership with them, because we have been trying in the past and this is not working at all because they are winning time. And this is really the point, not to go public. One of the actions we conduct here in France, it was about the anti-personnel mine. You know, and this is completely forbidden by the Oslo Treaty. But we found out that the main banks in France, there were funding, or okay, well, there were, yes, really financing, directly or indirectly, companies that were producing mine, this type of mine, even if it was forbidden, okay? At the beginning, they refused even any dialogue, any concertation. The first we start with was AXA. And we have a very, very, very strong campaign with AXA financing the production of this kind of mine. They Okay, they declared that, okay, they stopped financing, etc. Then we went to the other banks, and we went to Société Générale, Paribas, etc. And one of them, they refused. We sent a letter. They refused. A new letter. We tried to meet them. Then we sent them a letter to tell them, okay, listen, all the orders they have signed, if you don't sign and if you don't accept the, you know, to stop the financing of this kind of activity, tomorrow we will go public with our report. In the night, we receive the mail saying that they stopped financing this kind of activity. And then we didn't launch the report, but we make sure that the commitment of those monks was public. And for them to also, we asked them to put in place tools to really be sure that the activity they were financing, directly or indirectly, they were not producing anymore this kind of mine. And then here you have some example of the main campaign we have been working on. Some of them are really very emblematic. Okay, there is the case of Bhopal. Bhopal, it was 30 years ago. Okay, and what is really typical and is this for this the reason why this case is so important is that if at the beginning 10,000 people died because the effect of the leak of it was a gas leak, okay, and this was really very toxic, but because the company didn't clean up the area, they didn't clear it, and today it's still polluted and still people are dying because of the pollution 30 years ago. And also you can see that since then over 500,000 people died. And at the beginning the company just gives, you know, the compensation they gave, it was nothing. But since then, because the site is not clear, because the people are continue to dying, you know, the justice try to, you know, we are trying to make, to bring them to court. But the company that it was Human Carbide, Union Carbide Corporation India was sold to Dow Chemical in 2001. And since then, they are saying, and they are based in the US, they are saying, we are not responsible. This was the former company. And they still refuse to remedy that and to compensate the people accordingly and to clear the site. And but you know, it takes really long time, but in November 2014, at least the Supreme Court in and the government in India, they have agreed to reopen the file in order to review the compensation of the people and to make more pressure on Union Dow Chemical now. But it takes a lot of time, as you can see. And this is clearly the problem with, you know, the main corporation, the mother company, and the entities, how they can escape from the law just because they say this is a subsidiary, we are not responsible for that. The other big problem is the value chain, when we say the sales party, and what's happened with the Rana Plaza in Bangladesh. This was in 2013. I guess you follow up this, you know, in Bangladesh, there are several suppliers that, subcontractor for the textile industry. And there, because of the collapse of the building, as you can see on the picture, over 1,000 people died there. The problem is that, in fact, because the supplier, they say, okay, they were working for their company. And not only that, they say the condition, you know, that they have to work to achieve the price they were selling the product, you know, it's the responsible for that. And they don't have enough money to compensate today the people. And all the chain, you know, the different step of the chain, they reject the responsibility to the others. At the end, you know, the compensation is still here. Some brand company that they are selling the textile, for instance, in Europe, some of them gave some money for a fund to compensate, but it's almost nothing. And still now, some of them, they are refusing. It's the reason why, for instance, in France, we have a law project that is at the Senate level today, that we are working here with the MPs it's not to make them responsible, but at least to make them responsible of the due diligence. It means that, you know, to review all the different steps of the chain, to ensure that the price they are paying, okay, allows to have security for the employees, and that what they are buying, it's produced under minimum condition and respecting human rights. But it's very difficult because, again, they are really, really lobbying, and they have more power than us to make lobby, of course, in front of the MPs. And this lobby, they refuse completely to have any responsibility, even in the due diligence. It means that to be sure that they respect the they make the review of the process to be sure that the human rights are respected by the third party. The mine sector, as I told you, is the one with the major violation. The reason why is that mine sector is about land already. And then just because of the land, you have forced eviction. And this is a big problem because in many companies, and mainly in the company where you have the mining extraction resources, okay, they don't have land property. It means that the people, they don't have the land property, and it's very easy to evict them. And as you can see here, to evict them, most of the time, you know, they are using the force. And this is the collusion between the corporation and the state, not to protect, but really to violate human rights. Then is the problem of the pollution. And because the mining sector or the mining extraction also is a very polluting industry. And if you don't take the appropriate measure to control this pollution, it's going to have an impact on health and the livelihood as a whole. Then you have also the question of the labor condition, and many countries, the people who are working on the mine are children because it's very easy to exploit them, and they are small, they have physical aptitude, etc. And it's really about exploitation. And at the end, the question is not only about all those rights violated, but it leads to violence, conflict. And we can see that today, for instance, in Central America, the area with really more with the presence of army, police, etc., it's the mining area. And it shows clearly how the people enter in this kind of conflict, and everybody is surprised when something happens. Very quickly about Shell. Shell in Nigeria, it's of course, Shell is the first oil producer in Africa, but Nigeria is the first oil producer in Africa, yeah, and Shell is the first actor in this country. And the big issue here is that for the last 50 years, we have really over 13 million barrels of petrol, okay, that, oh, it's, it's still in French. Okay, that the pollution is really, really huge. And you see all those pictures that where the land is covered with oil, the water is covered with oil. It means that you cannot even fish, you cannot, you know, there is no more agriculture, etc. And for all those years, Shell has been refusing. And okay, this is the kind, I speed up. And this is the kind of campaign we have been conducting to, the objective here is really to make public aware about the situation. And on top of report, we had events, sitting, etc. But it was, Shell was the headquarters in Europe. They denied and they say, no, this is about leaks, this is about, yes, robbery, etc. We are not responsible. Anyway, in Nigeria, this is an independent subsidiary. We are not responsible about the, what they do. Okay? But one of the examples of the action we are conducting here is the Bodo community, where in 2008 we had to suffer two pipeline leaks with thousands of barrels of oil. There were diverse here, and the contamination and the oil, the soil and water contamination was very high. In 2011, okay, and. We bring to court. We went to the Netherlands, we went to different countries, but at the end, in 2011, a court in the UK accept the claim, and Shell was still denying, okay, rejecting the fault. But because of the proof and in the investigation, when it comes to the point that it was really obvious that they will be condemned, they decide to negotiate a compensation. And you can see the compensation, £65 million, almost 70 million euro. Okay, they gave the money. The problem is that they still didn't clear the area, and it means that, okay, the people, they have the money, but once it will be used, what they will do, okay? And then we continue to work on this. And the last one is the, and maybe, you, yeah.
We can call the person, no? Who is in charge of the video?
Vous savez après comment mettre la vidéo? Ah. Okay, but and the last one, what I presented at the beginning, is the cobalt mining. Je l'avais lu. Quelqu'un l'a pris? Can you enter your login and your password? Parce que en fait, je ne sais pas qui a pris mes... Ah, ils sont dessous. C'est dessous l'ordinateur. OK. This is cobalt mining. Well, we have been working on mining on Guatemala, on Myanmar, and many different countries. And this is the last one. We are working... one of our targets is the mining sector, as I said, but it is... Also, it's the area where we have more problems. It's Africa, Latin America, and some part in Asia. And in the Democratic Republic of Congo, as you know, all the area of the Katanga and the Kivu, etc., it's very, very rich in mining, but not only on diamond, but or gold, but also the new metal we need, you know, the new mineral we need for the new technology. And this area, it's in terms of conflict, you know, this conflict are, now we have conflict in the area for over 30 years. And most of them, if they are not related with the mining is what allowed the different armed groups to finance the war. And you know, it's all the area of the, of course, the Democratic Republic of Congo, but you have the Burundi, the Rwanda, etc. And you know how touchy is the area. And at the end, in the Katanga and the Kivu, the war never stopped. And it's about the violation committed by the extraction of the mining, but also about the violation against committed against the population. And in the conflict area, one of the most common violation committed, it's on top of course of killing people, etc., is the gender and women violation. And in the Katanga, we are working both on the mining extra, how to finance the armed group. We also work on the armed group itself. There is no state there really to apply any law, and also on the violation committed by women, and it's mainly rapes and other violation, and it's a very, very severe situation. I just alors pour aller sur ah oui oui c'est alors je vais faire alors alors, just to show you the video. The video will explain you. Oh, attends. Sorry. C'est pas. Ah, ah, ah. OK.
This used to be the kitchen in somebody's house. It's now the entrance to a tunnel that goes deep underground. These men have to be careful as they descend, holding onto small ledges on the sides. What they're after is one of the rarest metals found on Earth, cobalt. And the Democratic Republic of the Congo is the source of more than half the world's supply. Much of it comes from hand-dug artisanal mines like this one, some up to 60 meters deep. Cobalt is used in the production of lithium-ion batteries, the sort that power your electrical devices, like smartphones and laptops, and also the batteries in electric cars. But these miners, who are too poor to own laptops or smartphones, risk their lives for those who want them.
Over the past year, there have been at least 80 fatalities in these mines. But we also spoke to people who said that many accidents aren't reported and bodies are just left buried underground.
They don't have any basic tools, safety equipment, or protective clothing, nor do they wear face masks to save them from a near invisible poison.
Inhaling cobalt dust can be extremely dangerous. It can cause a fatal lung disease called hard metal lung disease.
It involves long hours and back-breaking labour for little reward. And for many, it's the only employment around.
En 30 ans, moi, je suis élève. C'est donné sur la peau. J'ai pas d'argent. C'est pourquoi je l'ai fait pour avoir quelque chose pour retourner à l'école. Bon, quand j'ai gagné, j'ai mis petit à petit. Parce que c'est une année de maquis. Après tout cet argent-là, je vais partir avec l'école.
This is the neighborhood of Kazulo in Kawezi City, in the south of the DRC. Residents discovered cobalt here in 2014 and have since hand-dug hundreds of holes in the ground.
These mines are extremely dangerous because these miners aren't getting any support from the government. They don't have technical training. There aren't supports within these mines.
This region has the potential to be one of the world's richest mining areas. There are dozens of large industrial copper and cobalt mines, but most people live in poverty and scrabble around for a living. It isn't only adults who dig for cobalt. So too do children, earning as little as $2 a day, and they are ripe for exploitation.
The United Nations, which is based in the DRC, says that there are at least 40,000 children working in these artisanal mines in the southern part of the country. How many are working on cobalt as opposed to other minerals, we don't know, but it's clearly a very large problem.
Just arriving now at a place called Malo. It's a lake where women, and we've got some children as well, wash the ore that comes out of the artisanal mines.
Youngsters like 13-year-old Charles do this because they can't go to school. Many make a charge to cover teachers' salaries, uniforms, or for learning materials. His father, Francois, says that it's hard even to get enough money to eat.
It starts with the miners. They work for themselves or for, you know, other miners, maybe wealthier miners or the landowner. After the mining, they fill up their sacks and then they put them on the back of cars or motorbikes and they take them to a market called Masompo. This is a market for minerals outside of the city of Kolwezi. They take it to this market where there are dozens of individual trading houses owned by primarily Chinese businessmen and women.
The local traders sell most of the cobalt to a company called Congo Dongfang Mining, or CDM. It's a wholly owned subsidiary of one of China's largest mineral product manufacturers, Hayo Cobalt. CDM has its own smelting operation, which processes the ore before exporting it to its parent company in China. Hayo Cobalt sells its products to component firms in China and South Korea. Those companies sell their products to other battery manufacturers, with the final product, lithium-ion batteries, sold to household names in Japan, Europe, and the USA, like Apple, Samsung, Microsoft, Sony, and Volkswagen.
We believe that companies have a responsibility to ensure that they aren't in any way profiting from human rights abuses.
Responding to Amnesty's allegations, Hayo Cobalt said,
"Our company has not been aware that any of our legitimate suppliers has hired child labour in their mining sites or operated in unsafe working conditions. CDM has rigorously selected its ore suppliers to ensure the procurement of raw materials through legitimate channels."
LG Chem, one of the world's largest battery manufacturers, confirmed it acquired component metals through this supply chain and says it's now taking active steps to investigate Amnesty's findings. LG Chem supplies Apple with batteries.
Tapping, swiping and pinching have forever changed the way we navigate and experience our digital world.
And the technological giant only commented to us by addressing the broader question of due diligence, saying it was
currently evaluating dozens of different materials, including cobalt, in order to identify labour and environmental risks, as well as opportunities for Apple to bring about effective, scalable and sustainable change.
Sony said,
"We take this issue seriously and have been conducting a fact-finding process. So far, we could not find obvious results that our products contain the cobalt originated from Katanga in the DRC."
Volkswagen said,
"To the best of our knowledge, the cobalt in our batteries does not originate from the DRC."
Samsung said it had no direct links to CDM or Hayo Cobalt, adding,
"It is impossible for us to determine whether the cobalt supplied to Samsung SDI came from the DRC Katanga's mines."
Microsoft said,
"We have not traced the cobalt used in Microsoft products through our supply chain to the smelter level due to the complexity and resources required."
The simple answer is that if Amnesty International can do it, they can do it.
Amnesty is now calling on Apple and other giant technology companies to properly investigate the original source of the cobalt in their products. If it is sourced from the DRC, they and the DRC government should ensure that children are removed from the mines and working conditions for everyone else are made safer.
this was just a good example of how it works, but also what are the challenges for us, where we found the biggest difficulties when we have a weak state not enforcing law, when we have different corporations and suppliers and entities that compose the chain of value. And at the end, when you have big and major company that they claim about their moral responsibility, but in fact, you know, they just show up, they just communicate positively, but they do nothing to really protect human rights. Thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you very much for President's presentation, which is very informative and inspiring. And my name is Chia Huan, and this is my partner Inga. And in the next 20 to 30 minutes, we are going to present some ideas in response to your presentation. And here is the structure of our presentation. And in the beginning, we will also present some, have some brief introduction of the international Amnesty International. And then Inga will talk more about the CSR and also the role of NGO. Later on, I will also bring more cases of the more human rights issues to discuss about. And as we think that it is a very special opportunity to have you here, so we try to include as many topics and issues as possible. So although we just have limited of time. And in the last section of the presentation, we will have some questions and debates. Okay, so to begin with, in the material that you sent us, there are two cases that shows us the irresponsible corporations and also the irresponsible governments. They damaged the environment, but the government didn't take any actions. Like even after decades, there are still a lot of victims and they didn't have enough subsidy and to deal with their health problems. Later I'm going to bring more human rights issues, and I'm going to discuss all these human rights violation issues in a synthetic ways. Okay, so now let's take a look at the Amnesty International, the background. And as you've mentioned, it's founded in 1961 in London, and Amnesty's jobs includes media attention, legal advocacy, as well as lobbying, and to name just a few. But the main focus issues may vary with different countries. Like in China, the main focus is on the death penalty or the freedom of speech. While in France, the main focus is like discrimination or refugee issues and immigration issues. Yeah. And also there, I put the motto of the Amnesty International, it is better to light a candle than to curse the dark. I think it is very inspiring and warm-hearted. So that's why I think maybe that's how their logos come from. And in the next slides, Inga will present more about CSR and the role of NGOs.
Yes, so firstly, I would like to start with a brief introduction of this human rights and business ethics concepts, and it comes in 16th century when with natural rights it develops until after World Wars it become internationally known and included in Declaration of Human Rights. However, and you see there is a classification, it's based on actually French Revolution, Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité, all the rights, and actually it developed a lot through this time. You mentioned there are a lot of treaties, conventions, and declarations. However, it's not binding, and no set of law is established. And what I want to point out that it was included in many countries' constitutions, and this created kind of division of responsibilities for public and private sector. So it's social responsibility is more for government, and public and for private sector is more profit maximization and this wealth generation. So business ethics comes to as a study of field in 70s and continuing commitment of business to behave ethically and to contribute to economical development, including not only workforce and their families, but also local community and entire society, is called corporate social responsibility. And this term is actually very debatable, and you can even find it contradicting between two economical schools, which says, for example, neoliberal economics says that it's violation of free market and conflict between government, public, private, and non-profit sector. And you know this famous Friedman quote of that social corporate responsibility is to maximize profit in under legal requirements. And we have another school which says that without restraint and without ethical program, growth of a companies will be short-lived. Which is Director Seidman, who was influenced by Schumpeter thoughts. So we have this big and complex framework of with dealing with CSR, and you see in the bottom this is the dimensions of these 17 goals of development as that we heard yesterday in the seminar. And in the center you see multinationals working in the local firms and going there through foreign direct investments. This was mostly analyzed in literature, but also you can see it's in international trade and pro-poor activities also should be more analyzed because it also have a big impact. And of course, there is an impact of government, non-governmental institutions and governmental and international instruments. So this big framework leads us to analyze big issues. Of course, it's very complex, so we cannot focus on all of them, but we'll try to dig more into some major facts. So here you can see how companies are responding to this social responsibility and especially in environmental issues. There is a rejection or apathic view. We don't care too much. However, now companies include CSR in their strategies, and we say that, and this is, we want to open, we want to it to be seen as for reputation. It is called green marketing, but actually we do, we are far from real social responsibility. And there are only a few companies who really deal with, see it as a positive benefit. So we would like to ask what are really determinants of this kind of different responses to responsibility. And can we see that this is a fashionable thing, and for how long it will be fashionable to include this social responsibility, and what can we see a trend towards sincere and sustainable moral consciousness of business, and also we can ask ourselves what impact of other institutions like education have on this going to moral consciousness. So going to the legal and justice, legal issues and justice, we know that globalization make it easier for big companies to go to avoid the strict legal requirements and being good in the home country while being bad in host country. And we see this audit failures, bribery, insider trading, corruption, lobbying, all these issues are related, shows that there are blurring boundaries between public and private sectors. And some of the cases were exposed and published as you presented us, and we read a lot about this, but there is still this relatively not just paucity of fines, and in comparison with magnitude of offenders and resources that still remain in this dangerous hand. And there are a lot of politicians and executives who was not punished and escaped from it. So of course we should consider what, according to which national laws should we be punished, and what moral conventions should prevail, both of home country and host country, as we don't have this international set law. And also, as we can see with public and private partnerships, who parts the guardians. And the last issue I want to speak about is, of course, role of NGOs is very important. And it arises when governments are very easily influenced, and with rapid changes of economy standards and regulations are overwhelmed. So we can see three patterns that are followed by NGO pressures in industries. And some authors say that is crucial as a civic regulators, and we can see it. The NGOs' importance are growing very fast, and some are exploring it that effect on the short run is big. However, in the long run, in some industries, companies tend to quit the market. And also, some authors say that industry level of competition in the industry, industry specificities are very important in this issue, and we would like to ask what can be done to strengthen this process in a particular industry to go and advancing going for advancing human rights, and how can we mobilize all the society generally be affected of these issues. And also, as importance of NGOs are become growing very fast, we should ask also about accountability, transparency of NGOs, and the resistance of this corruption or lobbying in when working in these kind of conditions. So who is being called to account, who can be called to account when we see that everyone can be affected, and by whom. Further, Juanita will present some other issues.
Okay. To begin with, the prevailing market-oriented globalization should should make all the nations, all the countries to grow and to develop fairly and equitably. But somehow it turned out to be that there are some equality and the exploitation of the developing countries. Multinational corporations, they went into the developing countries and to gain to take advantage of the cheap labor cost, and to try to keep their cost as low as possible, and they reap the benefits and gain the profits in those consumer markets, and keeping their costs at very low in the developing countries. So, in addition to environmental contamination, MNE, they also brings other problems which violate the human rights. For example, child labor, labor exploitation, and improper working place, and improper working conditions. And in this light, you can see there are two little child, they are working in a field and in a factory. And what does this tell us? Not every child has the same fate. Those childs, they have to work, which deprive which deprived those kids of their childhoods. And they have no choice but to work in order to earn the income crucial to their survival. And for another case is that the president just mentioned is a Bangladesh case. This is an eight-story buildings. And this building is supposed to build for office and for shops. And this is not supposed to be used as a factory. And the building is collapsed because it is not strong enough to bear the weight and the vibration of the factory machines. Also, it is not possible to accommodate more than thousands of people just in one floor. But actually, they could have escaped from this disaster because several days ago before this disaster, there are some people that already noticed that there are some cracks on the wall and the buildings, there are some problems. But they cannot escape because they have a lot of pressure and they need to deliver the order to the buyers. The buyers like Zara, like H&M and so on. So some people there argue that like we really need to think who needs to take this responsibility. And is it the factory workers or their managers or those like Zara, H&M, those brands or the consumers? And it is like just president just said, it is the value chain responsibility. And another famous case, it's Walt Disney. Disney is said that they brings the happiest place on earth. But behind the stage is that in the Heidi factory, they just pay 12 cents US dollars per hour. And it is far below the minimum wage of Heidi. And there is another report entitled Looking for Mickey Mouse Conscious. And it clearly identified the abuses that in Chinese factory, including the excessive working hours, improper wage calculations, and frequent working place accidents. So what is the problems and the root cause? It's because that developing countries, they don't have money, and they really need to rely on those foreign direct investment to go into their market and to help them to develop and to help them to grow. So because they have no choice but to set aside those human violation issues and just surrender the multinational humanity violation. And here, there are some still possible cases and the possible solutions that I want to share with you. And one of the solutions is that, just as she mentioned it, we should have a regulation or some international standards that make all the corporations to to follow the guidelines. For example, there back in 1990, there is a Global Economic Council, and they introduced a global standard and make all the make corporations to sign. And those corporations, they sign for this agreements. They need to follow the standards, like they need to protect the environment and follow the labor or the human rights guidelines. And the other solution is that we consumer must to have the awareness. And there is a famous example of Nike. Nike, back in like 10 years ago, and the US media, they revealed that the inhuman condition in China and Vietnam. In China and Vietnam factory, and the laborers, they were treated unfair. So because this issue gained the public attention, and awakened the public. And what is the consequence of Nike? Because they do such things, and those consumers, they gradually they have some awareness that they shouldn't buy Nike's product. So Nike gradually lost the consumers' confidence, and they suffer huge financial loss, as well as they damage their reputations. So other competitors seeing this, they gradually aware of the CSR responsibility, and they try to devote this. They try to devote themselves into CSR, and also try to improve the labor conditions, just to create a positive image to the public, and to show that they try to contribute to this society and to gain the confidence from the consumers. And last but not least, this is one of the most ideal one, yet the most crucial one, is that they should not only have their awareness, but also they should try to bring this awareness to the developing countries and to their government, and to reform the society. And there is also a famous example of Levi's. Because, for example, back in 1990, because there is an incident happened in China, it's called Tiananmen. I don't know if you ever heard that. And in response to this incident that violated the human rights issues, and Levi's, they had the guts to exit the Chinese markets. And also, some incidents happened in Myanmar, and because at Levi's, they wanted to show that their opposition to this case, so they exit the Myanmar market as well. But a few years later, they went back again. So yeah, this is pretty much our presentation, and there are so many issues to stress, but we have just limited of time. But this is just a start, so we hope that everyone can can still think about it, and how we can try to deal with human rights problems. And here we come up with some questions and concerns we'd like to ask President.
Okay, so firstly, in our society, it's very important is to measure these achievements and profit we can measure easily, but how to measure this success in social responsibility. And during all of this, our presentation, we see that CSR is kind of limit and kind of contradicting terms. So it reflects in human rights and global economy risks. And so in the end, we would just like to conclude with the question, are we part of the solution or the problem? And how about the structure of our economic system, which oppose kind of the profit and people, and and usually the profit is who is winning. So what can be done, all of us, to change this? And so yes, this is our yes, and just a few related issues as you are working in.
Yeah, I have two more questions, and this is more open questions. And it seems that refugee and the immigration issues are a big focus in Europe recently, and we are just wondering that what actions have Amnesty International have taken so far, and especially we want to know that because German government and French government, they have different response to it, because German governments, they said in public that they are willing to take more refugees, while France government, they didn't have a very positive response on it. So in terms of this, because two governments, they play like, they have like different attitudes in it. And so do Amnesty France and Germany, they take different approach on the refugee issues. And the second one is like some of us are more interested in getting involved with the career in human rights fields or work for Amnesty International. So could you give us some suggestion or advice? So thank you. This is our presentation.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your presentation. And I will start with the last one. You know, to work with Amnesty, we should apply and follow up what is ongoing on the international website based because
we have also, of course, a job based in London, but also in the different hubs, but in Geneva to the UN, in but the council in New York, but we have almost everywhere, and everything is on the global website. Then when we have position, and we are recruiting a lot in different countries too, then please go there. And then we are recruiting so different kind of profile. You know, I was a few weeks ago in Mexico to visit the hub, and on 30, sorry, oh, it will stop. On 30 colleagues, you know, they were, they had 18 different profiles, you know, from sociology, even, of course, lawyers, but economics, etc. Then, you know, you just have to go to the website and apply. The other question, another question very short is the fact that Amnesty International, whatever the country where it's operating, we have just on a topic, we have one position that apply everywhere because it's based on human rights. It means that even if they, today, you know, the orientation for refugee is different between Germany and France. We have at Amnesty level exactly the same recommendation, and we are campaigning together anyway. But not only with them, this is a European issue, and we are campaigning at the European level to make the regulation change at the European level and at the country level. But on each subject, on each topic, we have exactly the same position. Worldwide, okay. Then coming back to the one of the question is it's not directly linked. You raised the question. Who? It's one of the points is opposed to you is who? It's watching the watch. Who was the guardian? Who is watching the watcher, etc. And this is a very important point because you know there are thousands of NGOs around the world, and many of them, if not most, at the you can find in the in New York at the UN headquarters or in Geneva, are financed and even you know created by state. But when it comes to NGOs that are completely independent, and it goes also to Human Rights Watch and, for instance, the FIDH in France, that, etc. The point is that you know we are not an international organization, government organization. We are an NGO. When we issue a report, we are not bringing to court. We are not judging. We just ask. You know, state and international organization, or in this case, corporation, to take measures, but to investigate themselves. We are not here to make the justice and to say who are the good guys and the bad guys. It's just we identify problem, they have to take the measure. Then the crew is watching us, they are watching us. And who is giving us the mandate we have, it's you, is the citizen. We are mobilizing the civil society. Then our legitimacy is coming from the civil society and the victim we are supporting. And this is really very important. And why it's so difficult today to mobilize on those issues. You provide very good examples on the, you know, how consumer, because the fact is the consumer, can make a difference when really they take into consideration, you know, the information available on human rights violation regarding the product they are buying or using. But, you know, this happened with really very big brands with a big awareness, and not only big awareness, but also a strong, very strong image. When you don't have a strong image, it's more difficult. And to be honest, the question of the image today, it's more perceived as a risk, okay? And the risk, you know, is not only about consumer, it's, I will say, the main risk for them is the share value today. Okay, because share value, when you are having a bad image in the media, of course you are losing consumer, and you can lose some turnover, etc. But the fact is, investors are afraid about risk. And what means risk is that if you go to court and you have to pay for million and or even billion of compensation to the victims, it can cost a lot, and they will lose their profit. And to be honest, today, when we are working on mining issue, except this case, because the product that there are concerned is really product first use people are using, and they are easier to mobilize. Okay, and this is an important point, but also there are very famous brands. But when you are talking about mining in Guatemala, that you don't even know, you know, who at the end will use to produce a device or other things. But we just can identify the mining company. Most of them are from Canada, South Africa, Australia, etc. And in some cases, we can identify the funds that are part of their shareholders. And we are working on the funds to make them aware about the risk and also the problem they can have to face if things go public. And this is how today, of course, the public is an important point, but the shareholder, the investor, the funds is one of the most important today because of the risk they can, the share value can decrease and they can lose a lot of money. And this is really important. When you ask how about the CSR, as I present, you know, we don't believe in CSR because CSR is a corporate social responsibility. And of course, you have companies that they are very high on the different level. Okay, they start to be, and if they communicate on that, it just, you know, I will give a typical example, and nothing to seek with corporation, but with state. You know, take the case of the young children, the picture of the young children, Elan, that was dead on the beach in Turkey. Okay, then, you know, big emotion, big public emotion all around Europe, but also all around world. What did the different governments in Europe? They say, we are going to take measures. Yes, this time we understood. After Lampedusa, after many, you know, killing, et cetera, we really are going to handle it and to do something. And the emotion went down because people were thinking, oh, they are going to handle, no more kids will die in the Mediterranean Sea. Okay, last year, almost 4,000 people died. And a big part of them were children. But after the picture, it continued because they did nothing, okay? But because they say, we will do it, okay, nobody continued to pay attention. It's the same with the corporation, you know? When they say, oh, we are going to take the measure, Everybody's happy because we feel that we obtained something with them. But who is following what they did? Nobody. And for this reason, you know, CSR is not enough because what they show up, but they don't anticipate. They don't take measures to prevent violation. They are not accountable about the measure they are taking. There is no real due diligence on their process. Okay, and this is the question. CSR is a voluntary process. You know, I am working in the pharmaceutical industry. The pharmaceutical industry have really good process when it's it's by law, and we can see all the time that there are accidents, I will say, to be positive. But you know. The regulation about healthcare, about medicine, you know, has been developed on big accident, on many people killed, and all the time they needed such an accident so for the state to develop new laws to force them to act and to react. And this is the point. Without that, you know, they will continue to say we are doing our best. Or, as you saw in the video, we tried, but we don't find anything. We didn't find anything at this stage, and this is the point. Okay? Then you know, CSR is definitely not enough. We need international law. Why we need international law? Because at the country level, we don't have the same level first of law that to protect, and then they escape from their obligation. Because they are operating in country where the system is very weak. And second, because of bribery, because of corruption, because of collusion, you know, anyway, even when you have laws, the government don't apply. Then the idea, and this is why we need a value chain responsibility, is that the one to pay is the one who collects the profit at the end and the one who is going to distribute the profit to the shareholder. Because otherwise, all the long of the chain, you can have this problem and nobody takes responsibility. Okay? I don't know how to mobilize civil society. This is very difficult. Unfortunately, most of the people feel more concerned about the trees or some animals, about the climate. It's important about the human. You know, we are so used to see people dying in conflict, okay? We are so used to see people now dying in the Mediterranean. We are so used to these images. And also about, this is about the government, you know, communication worldwide, is at the end, you know, when we show the picture of the people dying, are the people concerned? They are more concerned when they see animal dying. Because, you know, there is a kind of fatalism that, okay, we cannot save everybody. Okay, that some has to die. And this is really the issue. And I don't know who did that, but someone showed me a few days ago, it's a draw, and a kid asked to his mother, why they are giving the nationality of the people who has been dying after their name, because they had different nationality. And the mother said, it's just to know if we have to feel concerned or not. And this is the truth today. Regarding the nationality, regarding from where the people are coming and where they were living, we feel more or less concerned. And if the closer is to us, the more concerned we feel. And this is the big, big problem with human rights today, is that except for people that they are traveling, they have friends from abroad, etc., it's very difficult to say, you know, and is exactly what we see with the refugees today, and is exactly what we see with the question of the exploitation and children exploitation, etc. Is it could be me, it could be someone I know. No, then why I will care? And this is something we have to break, because otherwise, of course, this will not change. I don't know if there are other questions. Yes. From the what you asked me? Okay.
Okay. There are other questions within the room, so I'll take the microphone.
We have
okay. So I propose if you agree that we take a wave of questions.
What?
Three questions and then another wave. Don't forget to introduce yourself. Huh? Okay.
My name is Katerina. I will not mention my nationality.
I care about it, don't worry.
Okay. We have, it's very nice having you here. Thank you for coming. So my question is a bit connected to what Juanita asked, but from a bit other side. I'm interested about your opinion on a new public debate, what is going on now. Is migration a basic human right? What do you think? Thank you.
Okay. It depends. You know, it depends what you call immigration. If you are talking about what is happening today in Europe, it's not about immigration. This is about refugees. And to provide asylum to people who their lives is in danger, it's a human right obligation. This is coming from the humanitarian human right, and this is the Geneva Convention. Okay, the problem, if I can explain little, is that when this convention has been adopted, it was at the end of the Second World War, and the convention has been designed for refugees that were coming from Europe. And then, you know, everybody thought, oh, if we have another war, we need to have a refugee protection. And in fact, then it was applied, and for this reason, very often we speak about politics refugee, you know, because it was from the Cold War, and it was mainly people coming from the East, okay, escaping the communist system. Okay, but this convention at the end applies to everyone. And today we are realizing that we have also to fulfill our obligation. It wasn't just a text. You know, it's very nice. This happened quite often with government. We have convention treaties, but then when they have to apply, they say, oh no, we cannot. And this is what's happening today with the refugees. And this is unbelievable, because, you know, we have, and when we talk about the question of the refugee in Europe, we have 20 million refugees on the worldwide, okay? And, you know, we are making a big story, because this year, you know, we had 1 million people coming to Europe on a population on over 560 million people, okay? In Lebanon, okay, there are 3 million Lebanese, 1 million refugees. It means that when you make the comparison to say that it's a problem for us, no, it's a problem for the refugee and it's a problem for the world. But we have to consider that to provide asylum to people who have their life in danger, it's an obligation. For the other migrant, it's the decision of the state to accept or not. You know, they have relationship with other states, you know, there are several, but the refugee, in theory, we shouldn't refuse any refugee.
May I comment? Yeah, exactly, my question was concerning this, and the point, so as I understood, there is a violation of basic human rights by the most developed countries that close their borders in this extreme time. And for example, Hungary, who exactly was a refugee in 50s, and it's very interesting how they now close the border for refugees from another country. So states can only declare when they sign this basic human rights, but there is no guardians again who are watching them, how they implicate this basic human rights, right? So that there is no one who will say, no, you cannot do that. That is basic human right. You have to open the border.
Yeah, in fact, you know, it's the first, we always forget that when we create the Bill of Human Rights with the Declaration, the Covenant, and then the other treaties, it was first to protect the citizen of the people from the state. Okay, and you are right, who is watching the state? And in theory, it should be the UN, but the UN is composed by the state themselves. And for this reason, there are NGOs, and this is, you know, our role. It's to make our own investigation and then to make it public, because if we don't make it public, nobody is going to do that. The question is how we move the system, because the system is composed by the government. You know, we are right now, we can see that now there are at the European level, European Union, there are measures that, okay, they have started some process regarding the decision taken by Hungary, but they will do two others. But the question and the difficulty is the European Union to do something on that? You know, I remember very well, and this was another time, it's about the rendition during the war on terror. When it came public, and we have been working on a lot of that, that people were kidnapped from, because it was really about kidnapping from one country. They were tortured in some parts, even in Poland or in some, I think in Romania or other countries, and then they were transferred to Guantanamo, to Abu Ghraib, etc. Okay? And all of a sudden, we realized that state government, European government, were behind that, supporting the US government on the war on terror. You know? And the only entity was the Council of Europe. Council of Europe, because of the NGO finding on this matter, they initiated their own investigation. They made a huge report. With the report, they went to the European Commission, and they asked the European Commission to take action against the state who did it. Mm-hmm. Nothing happens. But why nothing is happening is still, again, is because you, the public, the citizen, you know, once it say, oh, we are doing a report, we are reviewing, they forget. The media forget. The journalists forget. And if we are not watching them all the time and demanding of that, you know, they will continue. And this is why it's, you know, all right. It's something we have to protect and to defend and demand to the state to respect them. If we don't do it, they will not do it.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
My name is Mahar. You kind of answered my question with Katerina last part, but it's also a specific case. You have many reports on the prisoners of conscience, and it's really interesting to read everywhere in the world. But the thing is, in a case in a failing state such as Syria, let's say, when the state is committing these violation of humanitarian international law, how could you, for example, collect evidence from prisons where I know, like, it's barely impossible for any organization to enter prisons? Although it's true, like all the public statements I saw, it's very true and it's very detailed. The second question is, how can you send teams there, which I know it's also nearly impossible, and can you take like in terms of enforcement, rather than going public or giving it to the EU, can you, for example, put it, give it to the International Criminal Court in case of war crimes? Can you testify or you cannot? Because I know other organizations cannot testify, even though they have a really close observation of these kind of issues. And what can you do about, for example, these kind of issues is really sensitive. People are dying every day, and I know it's all over, but maybe because it's very close to me. But how can you improve conditions in very like rapid way, while, for example, the last report you issued on political prisoners, it was based on the 5,000, 15,000 photos from Syrian prisons where people were starved or tortured to death, but still it was very documented and but like no action has been taken, as if everyone was zombies or something.
Yeah.
And my second question is related to...
This was the first.
Okay. My second question is different. It's on child rape labor. I'm not saying that children must be allowed to work or at all, but the thing is, when you say we should stop child labor, it's like one-side action kind of thing. We don't, for example, if you tell a company, please stop, and they oblige, children still, in many countries and cases, support families. And since you don't have alternative for the children or their families, that means the action created more trauma than it. Like, I understand the basic human, like children rights, but still it will make more families suffer, or maybe it will make more families starve or something like that. So thank
okay.
you.
Okay. Okay. On the first question, it was a very wide question. To make our own investigation or main research, of course, we send people to the field, but it doesn't mean we can do it at every time. Okay, when we want to investigate in France, in the US, I will say, but in some country, okay, even to Tunisia, to the, it's getting more and more difficult, but we can do it. There are other countries that don't let us enter into their country. We cannot. You know, I have been trying to go to Algeria for many times. They refuse. We have been trying to go to Saudi Arabia, for instance. They refuse. When is the conflict period? Of course, they refuse. But we have different way of working. First, it's we have been working on human rights and with the prisoner of conscience for the last over 50 years. It means that in most of the country, all the country, we have connection. Okay, we have connection with lawyers, even with doctors. And it's not only the last generation. For with some of them, if you take the case of Syria, we have been defending the grandfather, defending the fathers, and now we are defending the children. But when I say the children, is the youth. There are 20 years, and some of them has disappeared. It means that, you know, we have a long-term connection in the country. And from them, even if it's, we think it's impossible for them to send out information, we can get them, because they know people in the prison, they know people in the hospital. We can know exactly the name of the people who have been dying and how, etc. It means that we can collect information from different sources, and this is really the important point, is that when we cannot go ourselves on a country, on a field, to make our investigation, we always need different sources to collaborate. We work also with experts, with forensic experts, arm experts, etc., because we work on the picture, on the video, to be sure that what we are going to say, okay, there are real facts, and this is really difficult to achieve, but we can do it. And for instance, in Saudi Arabia, we know exactly who is in jail today, what is happening for them, how they were condemned, etc. Because also the family contacted us, etc. You see, it's a whole process. I don't know if this first part, you have other question on this?
The testimony at the International Criminal Court.
Ah, okay. We collect, and this is the point. We collect a lot of evidence and testimony. When we go on the field, we take video, picture, we analyze. We have a lot of testimony. We don't go directly for court, because our purpose is not to define who is bad or who is good. We support the victim, okay, they want to go to court, that's for sure. We provide what we have as proof, and our report. Anyway, our reports are used today by the UN, by the different committee of the UN. The Committee for the Enforced Disappearance, for instance, we are in continuous contact with them. We provide name, we provide proof, we provide them with facts, but they decide what to do. And one of the latest case, it happened because we have our, comment the archive? Archives, okay, we have our own archive. And for instance, when in Haiti with the earthquake, you know, the Justice Department burned, okay, they lost all the document about the, now he's dead. It's, le dictateur. Non, Haïti. C'était Babidoc, mais now he's dead. I forgot his name. There are new dictators, but you know, and because everything has disappeared, they have contacted us to provide our archive to reconstitute their archive. Okay, this is the way. We don't testimony, but you know, we bring a lot of elements, etc. Regarding the children, okay. The question, and this is clearly said in the movie, okay, why, the question is why we are, you know, child, they can found a job and to finance their family, and one is not the parent. It's because the kids, you pay less money, okay, and they are more flexible, they are not going to complain, okay, and then this is unfair. It means that, of course, if they don't work, they are not going to make any money. But we can consider that their parent will make it, okay? Because today the parent, they are not making money, okay? In some cases. And because we give them too low salary, okay? Of course, it's not just to say, children, they don't have to work. It's all the system that it has to be watched. And when we say they don't have to work, it's because we think that they have to go to school. Because it's not just a fighting for human rights, it's also fighting against poverty. And what we know is those children, they don't go to school, they will continue in the same poverty. And this is not what we want. We want them to be able to go to school, to have a good education, at least a minimum education, to find a better job tomorrow. This is exactly one of the issues we have with the Roma population, not going so far. If you take the Roma population in Europe, they don't have, in many countries, they don't have access to the educational system. Okay, they are sent to special school where they cannot get a good level of education, and we know that tomorrow they will not get a good job, and they will continue the same poverty. And we are going to say, oh, those people, they don't want to work. Those people, they are not able to work. But we don't start with the education. Then it's not just about the labor. Okay, of course, it's the condition of labor, but to is the education and the whole system.
Okay, hello, I'm Alexi. I have a question which is not really related to Amnesty International directly, but I would like to have your opinion about this. Like a few weeks ago, there was this advertising campaign by Médecins du Monde, which raised some critiques. I don't know if you see what I mean. So those ads in the metro with making people feeling guilty in a way, and a lot of people were saying it was not really a good way to achieve it. There were also like complaints about the fact that this marketing cost a lot, and it's the marketing society was not indeed very fair or ethic in a way, and so going from the private world. So I mean, is it, what do you think about this communication issue for an NGO? How is it possible to make some communication and to raise some funds, but also to have a communication which can raise consciousness without being into the sensational thing and really leading to a consciousness into the population. So I know it's not directly related to Amnesty International, but I would really like to have your opinion about this. Thank you.
It's a question we have to consider. First, of course, as NGOs, and this is the it was Médecins du Monde.
I
think so. I think I saw it, but I was not shocked. But at the beginning, I didn't understand where they were going to. My first point, it was unclear for me what do they want, because they were saying, oh, you are saying no when you have people asking in the street, you are saying no when you are receiving mail, but I think at the end of the day, you can go to our website, something like that, okay? Okay. We have rules in terms of communication agreed, and we have a chart for communication. For me, this was, this was nothing personally. It was nothing shocking. And when I saw it, I didn't feel guilty because I giving. Now, even if I don't give to them, I am giving money. I feel concerned, and I wasn't feeling guilty. Then. For me, it was nothing so shocking. But we have always the concern about how far we can go to the communication. Amnesty itself is not communicating at all to raise money. We are not making advertising. And I can understand people can be concerned because they have this campaign about, and it costs a lot. But on the other hand, you have to see that today they need money, and if they want to be independent, impartial, they have a lot of work. It's very, very difficult today for such organization because, when there is a big catastrophe, for instance, the biggest one, I think, who helped to raise a lot of money was the tsunami in Thailand, Indonesia, because a lot of tourists, it's the what we call the emotion kilometer. it has to be very close to you. Okay, well, it's not just the kilometer in terms of distance, but there were tourists. Then people felt concerned because tourists were from Europe, and they were showing people, from France, etc., of different countries, and they feel concerned. Okay, and they gave a lot of money. But at the end, they gave it for the tsunami. And few months later, you have an earthquake in Afghanistan with thousands of people, with nothing, no tent, with no house, etc. Nobody gave a penny. Because who cares about what is happening in a valley in Afghanistan with Afghan people? And then they have the problem how to raise money, and not just for a catastrophe or a specific issue, but generally. And then they spend money to that. How they did, how much it cost, I don't know. But sure, okay, it's how we can get money to stay independent, because otherwise it's the state who is going to say, please go to this country, please go to this country. And then who is going to care about the people? Nobody cares. This is then also about the limit of the communication. There are some limits, this is another aspect today with the public. They want to be shocked. Okay, they don't want to see things that they are going to make them feel guilty. Okay, but how you fill the gap between to make them guilty and to make them consider that is an issue, and the other one is to finally don't look at it at all. And it's very, very difficult how you make, where you put the line, And if you show only people smiling, everybody likes the campaign, but nobody's giving money. To do what? And You know, this is really, really the difficulty. And sometimes, you know, it happens to me that for one of our videos, we have a claim from a psychiatric group in France, and I have to go to the agency that take care about the ethical of the advertising, etc. And my line of defense, I will say, it was very simple. We are showing nothing regarding what is in our reports. Go to our website, look at the video we have on our website, and these are available to the public, okay? And what you will read in this report, you know, it will be, you will not sleep at night. When we describe the way people are tortured, it was one of the questions, you know, now I remember. The way people are tortured, the way people are killed, women are raped, okay? It's a nightmare. We are not showing that, okay? And it's nothing regarding, and then it's how we make people aware about what is happening, not shocking, but making them conscious. It's a big issue today. Okay.
Thank you very much for your answer. You already answered. I just want to say to everybody, because to be clear about this specific campaign, it's also the fact that it was making people feel guilty, not for not giving, but for not answering to people who come in the street and saying, I don't have the time to discuss, and for not answering to solicitation in the street, which is a bit different. It's not exactly the same thing than to say, because you can, in a way, like, don't answer. So that was, and why is this reaction? I ask this question because there was a kind of good reaction, but I think you answered very well to this question. Mm. I just wanted to precise because it was in French. I don't know if everybody saw it, and so it was a reaction.
I saw I can understand.
My name is Gabriele, and I want to ask about security in general of the members, because when you say about pressures and reports to make the investigations public, especially dealing with people that in certain way, if they are doing it, they are assuming the risks of what they are doing, and they are, I think, showing that they would take what it takes to do that. And so if I imagine that can exist some threats to the people that are working in field and doing investigations, so what are the protections against it, and if what you do to protect your members? Because especially what I read about the women rights defenders, this is a really big issue of activists that were killed or suffered some attacks against them because of what they are doing. So what is done to the members in a way to like physical protection or even to the investigations in case?
Okay. The first issue about the people, the victim, or even the NGO, or the lawyer, or the doctor, the physician that are providing us with information, of course, we make public, you know, their name, their picture, etc., even only if they accept that. Otherwise, we change everything, and it's done on an anonymous basis. Okay, and all the information we get, of course, we have the element, okay, we have everything to document, you know, and the IDs, etc., but we keep it secret when because there are so many countries, just because to testimony to us, okay, or send us a mail, okay, they can be condemned and at 10 years jail, for instance, in Saudi Arabia, okay? Or just to send Twitter, etc. It means that in some cases, we really keep it secret because people are afraid, not only about the state, but armed groups or other people, okay? This is one point. Then, about our own member and our staff, it's really difficult. First, what we do is, for this reason also, we declare to the, we ask for a specific visa to the authorities. We declare to the embassies in the country from the, for instance, France, UK, etc. Depend which country the researchers are coming. And also we make it public. Okay, as much as we can, because this is sometimes the best protection. It means that it's quite difficult, okay, for a government, okay, to make disappear someone from Amnesty. Okay, it doesn't mean it doesn't happen. You know, I remember very well at the beginning in Egypt, you know, when the when it was 5 years ago on Tahrir Square, we sent researchers, we sent people, and we need people that they were speaking Arabic and English. They already know the Cairo, because in this kind of situation, you cannot go with a translator. You have to be able to manage the situation by yourself. And we have one girl coming from Syria, one guy coming from Lebanon, I think, one coming from France, okay? And they were present at the Human Rights Center with other local NGOs and human rights defenders when the army came and took them and to take them to the police station and then to a center, you know. Nothing really happens to them because they declare to be Amnesty. Okay, even if they were with handcuffs and on the feet, etc., and they could hear other people being tortured, etc. But it took us hours. But we went to the different foreign affairs ministry from UK and for France, and it was impossible for us to go for the Syrian girl. But hopefully, she was also from. She has the British citizenship, but we were pushing through the embassy to find where they were and you know, to identify and to make them free. It means that this is the kind of things we do in order to protect them. But you know, sometimes it's not enough. And sometimes, for instance, but last time also Morocco, comment dit expulsé. To ask some researchers that they were in Morocco to they arrest them just to send them back, you know, to deport them to Europe again, because they were searching on the migrants and on what was doing Morocco and also on torture. They deported them. But this is more the way it works, because they really. Are afraid about something happens to Amnesty, you know, because it will be a big noise. But we have also a member that they can suffer. And my colleague, for instance, from Venezuela, the former president of the Venezuelan section, has been targeted by armed group, and twice, one of them, he received bullet, okay? And this is difficulty. It happens to us that we can close some section. For instance, is what happened in Colombia years ago, and we had a virtual section, and of course we sent people there to research, but we couldn't have activists because it was too dangerous.
Okay, more questions?
And just if there are no more questions, just to come back to the and maybe to finish to end with that about the picture. Okay, because what you are calling, what you are talking about is the César report. Okay, and I don't know, you know what is the César report here in the room? Okay, César is the code name, okay, of a man who was working on a prison in Syria, in Damascus. And his role was he was a photographer, and his role was to take pictures about the corpse coming, the dead people arriving to the forensic service. But during the year, most of the body who he has to photograph were accident, street accident, sometimes police killed, policemen killed, etc. But it was a routine, and a low routine. And once the war started, he started seeing more and more body arriving. And because of the procedure there, they have to take 5 pictures of the body, okay, and to put the different number, and to identify the person. And the body he started receiving at the beginning were just bodies with bullets, but more and more he saw arriving tons of body. When I say tons, you have picture with, and those people were coming from the killing by the army or the other group, but also torture people. And what is really impressive, because it's about 7,000 people and it's over 50,000 pictures, okay? And you can see how people have died because of torture, because of starving, because even kids, because women, etc. And it's really a nightmare. Today the pictures, some of them are exposed at the Shoah Museum in Washington, just to show you how shocking is that. When he started taking those pictures, he decided, and he was so concerned, he asked someone what to do with that, and because he couldn't manage that. And someone asked to take the original, okay, and every day on keys, okay, USB key, he was taking the picture of the day, okay, he was taking the picture other photographs were taking in the prison he was working. And this prison was just below the hill where is the Bashar al-Assad presidential palace, just beside the French school in Damas, okay. All the officials were going around, and here in the middle of the prison, it was the hell. And he decided, he was a really ordinary man, a really a poor man, just a photographer. And he became really a hero because every day during, I think, 2 years, you know, he was taking the picture and knowing that if he was caught, he will become one of the cops dead by torture. And he also has to go through sometime, you know, the Syrian army checkpoint, and then the army. It was really, his life was really in danger. And those pictures were taken by other NGOs and other activists and were sent to Europe. At the end, he decided to leave, and they asked him to leave and his family too, because it was becoming too dangerous for him. And then it becomes the César report. He went to the UN to present the report. The first presentation, I think it was here in France, at the MOFA, organized with the US representative, several people. And we thought, oh, okay, the red line with the the chemical weapon, you know, in 2013 wasn't enough. But when you saw the picture, and we launched the report, we invite the people who testify, examine, and also, you know, all the information, all the picture, everything has been checked, verified that it's authentic, okay? And when we presented that, we thought this is really a red line. When you say 5,000 persons, you know, who die in the condition you can see in this picture, you say they are going to do something. Okay, they went to the UN, nothing. And you know, today, this is, we cannot believe how, you know, nothing happened with that. And this is the big point, is the world we are living today. We have been talking about the General Assembly of the UN, we are the Council, the committees, etc. But there is a body. This body is the Council of Security. This Council of Security has 5 permanent members: China, US, Russia, UK, France. Those 5 members, okay, they have a veto right. And to go to the international court, okay, is the Rome status. It means that is the jurisdiction that it's in charge of the crimes, war crimes, crimes against humanity, and crime of genocide. It means the worst crime, okay. But if the country doesn't have not ratified the this status Rome and is not part of the international committee criminal court, the only one who can ask to the court to look at the situation is the Security Council. Okay, and when it comes to Syria, 3 times Russia has opposed the veto. When it comes to North Korea, another situation we could talk, it's China. When it comes to other countries, it's the US. And, you know, the point is today that, you know, and really here again is the problem about the citizen, about how we demand, not ask, but really demand that they respect this commitment. You know, it's otherwise they will not do it. And this is a typical case. Who cares today about Syria? It became so complicated. For people, it becomes a question of politics. It's not Syria, is of course there are political issues. Of course there are economical issues. But the main issue today there, it's the human rights situation of the population. Over say 7 million people displaced that have been moved. Or more than 4 million refugees, some of them, you know, dying every day in the Mediterranean Sea. And the situation is worsening and worsening and worsening. And, you know, I don't know if you saw the question of Madaya. They just entered Madaya where people were starving. Last year we were campaigning on Yarmouk, another area of Syria, where people were dying by starving. Can you imagine that, starving? And, but nobody moves. Because today, unfortunately, you know, there is not enough pressure on the government that are part of the Security Council for them to take measures. And if the situation doesn't change, we will continue the same way, watching people dying. And then it's our responsibility, and it's already also your responsibility. And I don't want to make you guilty, but it's just each of one have to understand that we are human beings. We today, you know, we can benefit of the human rights. We are here, we can say whatever we want, and we can move, we can go outside, read newspaper, marry with whatever we want or not, work where we want, etc. This freedom had a cost, okay? And if we want to maintain this level of freedom, it will have new cost, and we see how we are having this cost, you know, the danger coming here. But we have to be conscious that, you know, human right is something we have to protect, because state will not if we don't demand for that. Thank you very much.